Welcome to the talk. Good afternoon. And as you can see, today we are going to talk about how to build event-driven architectures, and everything will be based on open source technologies. As you can see, I'm coming from Red Hat, but not all the technologies I'm going to talk about are coming from Red Hat. Just from, in case everyone is a bit worried that this is going to be a sales pitch or anything like that, this is not the case. In fact, first of all, let me do a short introduction. As you can see here, I'm Carles Arnal. I'm a software engineer, as I said, working for Red Hat. I am part of the Apicurio team. Here it says I work on Apicurio Registry. That is partially true. I work on Apicurio Registry, but the Apicurio community is a bigger umbrella with more projects than just Apicurio Registry. But in today's talk, Apicurio Registry is the project that is related to the data pipeline, right? And as you can see, I'm also an active Quarkus committer. For those who are familiar with the Quarkus project, you are probably more familiar with the Spring project. Quarkus is an alternative coming from Red Hat to the Spring project, a very interesting one. And I'm also an associate professor at the Polytechnic University of Catalonia, known as Barcelona Tech, for those who like fancy names. So, first of all, let me make a small warning, okay? This talk is going to be a bit different in the sense that I don't like presentations with a lot of text or anything like that. We will have 12 slides, and I will do a live demo. That demo will take most of the time of the presentation. So I'm making that warning because I know that most talks take questions at the end of the presentation. Since this is going to be a live demo, I would like that if you have any question in the middle of the demo, please raise your hand, ask the question, and we will continue from there. I will do my best to answer the question, okay? I think that's better because once we are in the middle of something in the demo, once we move to the next thing, it's going to be hard to explain what happened and what not, okay? So, continuing with the presentation, this is our agenda for the talk. First, I'm going to introduce you the different components and why we choose them, their benefits, their pros, their cons, and why they are a good fit, basically, for an event-driven architecture. That's the discussion for this talk, okay? As I said, I'm going to do a step-by-step walkthrough of deploying the entire data pipeline live in the talk, so I hope that the demo gods are with us because it's going to be a live demo using different tools like Strimzi, Kubernetes, and other open source tools, as I mentioned. And finally, I'll do a wrap-up, and I will share any thought we have in last minute, and open the floor for any last minute questions in case there are no questions during the live demo. Okay? So, let's start talking about the different components we have. The first component we have is OpenShift. OpenShift is an application development and delivery platform that allows you to streamline your workflows to get a production faster into production. It includes, for instance, building Jenkins pipelines, for example, but it includes a wide range of technologies and a wide range of things. Okay? You can also bring together development, operations, and security teams under a single platform to modernize existing applications. So imagine you have the classical monolithic architecture. You can start bringing your monolithic application to OpenShift and start breaking it into smaller pieces. Or in case you already have a microservice architecture, that is the newer trend, right? We are in software, we live in the cycle. Now people are starting to destroy microservices and going back to monoliths, right? The software is a cycle always. And of course, with OpenShift, you can also go to edge computing. Essentially, you can compute, you can deal with data, you can compute close to the device, close to the source of the data, close or as close as possible to the source of the data, okay? The next tool we are going to talk about is Strimzi. Strimzi is essentially a Kubernetes operator that allows you to deploy Kafka in an easy way, right? As easy as, and I'm going to prove it in the live demo, as easy as with a single YAML file, you can have your Kafka cluster running in Kubernetes. In this case, it's going to be OpenShift, but OpenShift is built on top of Kubernetes. Everything I'm going to share works on OpenShift, but it works on Kubernetes as well. So a typical deployment incorporating Kafka components, and that will be our case today, might include the Kafka cluster of broker nodes, It also includes the zookeeper cluster of replicated zookeeper instances and also the Kafka cluster for extended data connections. That will be our case today. We're going to deploy a Kafka cluster, okay? And then another component, the one I'm more proud of, basically because I work with that team, right? Is Apicurio Registry. Apicurio Registry is essentially, it can work basically as two things. In our case today, the use case that is interesting to us is the schema registry use case. What is a schema registry? A schema registry is basically, imagine you have an application that is sending messages to Kafka. Usually those messages are serialized using a schema and are serialized using a format. Either it is Avro, protocol buffers, JSON schema, whatever schema type you are using, right? So instead of sending the whole schema with your message, you just an identifier and externalize that information to the schema registry application, okay? So you have these benefits that you can see here. You can decouple the schema from your application, no more having the schema defined inside the application. You have a central location and a single source of truth for all your schema definitions. You can have different schema registry deployments, one for production, one for pre-production, etc., or just one, and having different access management controls. And of course, one of the very interesting things about the schema registries is that they are a centralized schema evolution place. You can define all the rules to ensure that your schemas can evolve in a safe manner, in the sense that you can define forward and backward compatibility rules for your schemas, and you try to define a new version of your schema that breaks those compatibility rules, then your producer won't be able to publish new messages, in this case to Kafka, but to any messaging platform, preventing those messages from being corrupt for the consumers. Okay? Then another very interesting tool for those who are not familiar with it is Debezium. Debezium essentially is a change data capture platform. And what's that? That is, in our case, we are going to be taking information from a Postgres database, publishing the changes in the Postgres database to Kafka, and getting those changes into Elasticsearch. How does Debezium does that? Debezium lets your apps react every time your data changes, in the sense that you don't have to change your application to modify the data. It continuously monitors the database changes, basically transaction logs, as you can probably imagine, and stream every row-level change from your application. You can see all the changes and deal with them as you see fit, right? So you can, as you can imagine right now, you can take that functionality from your application and put it into a different service. No more, as you can see in the second point, no more need for a single application to deal with everything. I'm going to update the database, I'm going to update the search indexes, I'm going to push the cache, I'm going to send the notifications, no more need for everything in the same application, right? You can have that code and that functionality separated into a different place. And as I was saying, it's looking at the transaction log, a very important part, because without that point, none of the others makes any sense, is that no matter the amount of your applications, when you have stopped processing the changes from the database, the vision will continue from there. Doesn't matter the amount of your application, so you are not going to miss any bit of your changes. Okay. Now we have finally the last tool, so to speak, that we're going to have in this presentation, that is Elasticsearch. Elasticsearch, as most of you know, is basically for searching. We are going to use it for build search indexes for application. And some of the characteristics is that it's very easily configurable. I can prove it in the live demo. It has very good scalability capabilities, and you can ingest data from any place, right? You can ingest data from a database. You can ingest data from any other place, right? You can ingest data from a lot of places. And now, getting into the interesting part. As I was saying at the beginning, we are going to use a PostgreSQL database in this presentation. That PostgreSQL database is going to be populated already with a few tables, in the sense that we are going to have, if I recall correctly, because it's been some time since I looked at the database. No, I was kidding. It's five tables. OK, Okay, one with customers, one with product items, a classical database. We are going to deploy a Postgres source connector that is going to take the changes in that database. It's going to publish those changes serialized into Kafka. How is going to do that serialization? It's going to serialize that information using this serialization technology provided. In this case, it's a schema registry, it's a Apicurio registry, the project I work for. So it's going to use that technology to serialize the changes in the PostgreSQL database, send that information serialized into Kafka using Avro, and then we are going to take those changes with the Elasticsearch Sync connector, and we are going to build a search index with those changes. You can see another element in the middle, that is the Kafka UI. The Kafka UI is a very interesting tool, it's another open source tool that allows you to browse your Kafka topics, your Kafka messages, everything that is related to Kafka, and we are going to see it in the presentation. Okay? And now, if you scan this QR code, it's a bit deformed, but if you scan it, you can. It will take you to the GitHub repository that is the base for this presentation. So I'm going to do it. If you're curious after the presentation, you can go to the GitHub repository, and you can do exactly the same as I'm going to do in the presentation. Okay, exactly the same. So I can prove that it works, and you can deploy the exact same thing I'm gonna deploy. So let me actually exit the presentation. Okay. And let me change this thing in here. Just a moment. So we can see the same. Because in the other screen it's a bit too small for me. So just a second, because I want you to have the other part in here. Okay. Okay. I hope it's readable. It's fine. I can make it bigger. It's fine? Okay, great. So let's start. This presentation basically starts with the very first component. Why? Because it's the component that every single component, you can see the information in here, in case you don't know what I'm talking about. So the very first component we are going to deploy is Strimzi, the Strimzi operator. Why? Because I'm going to use Kafka basically for everything. I'm going to publish the changes from the Postgres database to Kafka. So if I don't have a Kafka cluster to send those changes, I can't do anything. Okay, so for this presentation, I already have an OpenShift cluster deployed and available. It's basically very similar to a Kubernetes cluster in that sense. Okay, all the apply commands that you're gonna see in here aren't specific to OpenShift. You can do this very same thing in a Kubernetes cluster. Okay, so the very first thing I'm gonna do, for those who are not familiar with OpenShift, you can go to the menu in here, and I'm going to go to the Operator Hub, which is a place where you can install operators. In this case, I'm going to install the Strimzi operator that, as I have explained, is the Kafka operator. Okay, let me install it. And now, what's happening in here? This is creating a new deployment in Kubernetes in the OpenShift cluster. It's going to take a couple of minutes, more or less, to install Strimzi is the slowest thing in the presentation. I'm sorry about that. But as you can see, the deployment has been created. Now we are waiting for the deployment to be ready. Okay. And once it's ready, I'm going to continue with the presentation. Basically, this is going to allow us to define. It's going to create a bunch of custom resource definitions for the Kafka cluster, for the Kafka connectors, for the Kafka Connect cluster, etc. So I will be able to see all the information for my Kafka cluster, if it's ready, if it's not working, anything like that. I'm going to be able to see it. Okay. So I have promised it was going to be 2 minutes. It's been 2 minutes. So if I go to see the operator, as I was saying, now in here you have all this information. Okay. You have a tab for Kafka. This is for Kafka clusters. Obviously, I haven't created a Kafka cluster yet, right? So I don't have anything defined. Same for Kafka Connect, and same thing for Kafka connectors. Those are the three elements that we are gonna use today. Okay, the very first thing is just the Kafka cluster itself, the raw Kafka cluster. The second thing is the Kafka Connect runtime, and the other thing is the connectors that are deployed in Kafka Connect. Okay, so continuing with the presentation, the very first thing I'm gonna do, as you can probably guess from here, is to deploy the Kafka cluster. I already have a bunch of custom resource definition defined in my in this file. Since you have access to the GitHub repository, you can check what's in there. So I'm gonna create the, but this command, I can promise you that this command is gonna create the Kafka cluster, okay? So if I go here, and I need to wait a moment. Now, if I go to the pods section of my cluster in here, and I filter by project, otherwise it's gonna be a bit difficult. You can see that I have mentioned that usually the Strimzi deployment it consists of three things. One is Zookeeper, that is basically a coordinator for the cluster. The other one is the broker for Kafka. And then this this operator is gonna deploy another thing that is basically the operator for this cluster in particular. So as you can see here, we have three Zookeeper pods. Everything is usually deployed in a cluster manner, so there are three pods, and here there are three pods for the Kafka cluster. Once this is ready, this is gonna create another pod that is gonna be the operator, this one, okay? And once this is ready, our Kafka cluster will be ready. It's gonna take a moment, but now what I wanted to demonstrate early, if I go to my Strimzi installation, if I go to Kafka, you can see that now there is a Kafka cluster created in Strimzi. So I have created the Kafka cluster manually using the OC apply command in the terminal, but my Kafka cluster is still managed by Strimzi in my cluster, okay? And as you can see here, now the condition of the Kafka cluster has changed to ready. So now we have a Kafka cluster deployed. So let's continue with the presentation. And the next thing I'm gonna deploy is the user interface for Apache Kafka. What is the user interface? Is what I was mentioning with the user interface. I'm gonna execute the command and I will talk in the meantime. So this is the UI for Apache Kafka. It will allow me to browse my topics, my messages, the schemas, everything, okay? So now if I go to my cluster again, and I go to deployments. I just created a deployment for my Kafka UI, okay? I can see that I have a deployment, I have a pod for my Kafka UI interface that is running. Now, if I go here, routes, it's gonna take a moment for loading it, but you will see that now I have a very nice UI for Apache Kafka. In what sense? In the sense that I can, obviously, there won't be any topic in here, apart from the internal topics, because I haven't done anything yet, okay? But you can see that this user interface is already connected to my Kafka cluster, okay? Now, I'm gonna deploy the very next thing, that is, let me export my namespace, and this is gonna deploy the Apicurio Registry operator in the same sense. It's a Kubernetes operator that allows you to manage Apicurio Registry. Same with Strimzi for Kafka. This is the same, but for Apicurio Registry, okay? So let's go ahead and deploy the Apicurio Registry operator. Same thing. Fine, I have the operator installed, but I don't have any Apicurio Registry instance available to me, okay? So now, same thing as I have done with Strimzi. I have, the only difference is that for Strimzi, I have installed the Strimzi operator from the OpenShift console, and for Apicurio Registry, I have installed the operator manually. We already also have the operator available in Operator Hub for Apicurio Registry. It's just more convenient for me to do it that way. Okay, so as you can see here, this is gonna create an instance of Apicurio Registry. And you can see two things. The very first thing is that the new Apicurio Registry instance has been created, and the second one is mentioning that a Kafka topic, Kafka Strimzi has been created. What does that mean? That means that Apicurio Registry can work in two different manners, okay? The first one is a more traditional, if you will, in the sense that for storing all the information, it's gonna use a relational database. It can be Postgres, it can be SQL Server, it can be MySQL, and you get the idea, okay? Or the alternative, for those who have a Kafka cluster already available, like us in this case, you can use a Kafka topic for storing all the information, for storing all your information, all your schemas, all your rules, everything that the Apicurio Registry manages. Okay, and now if I go here, you can see that I have another route for my Apicurio Registry instance. The first time it takes a bit of time. The cluster is a development cluster, so it's not really, really fast. So you can see here that I have now my Apicurio Registry instance without information, but it's available. For now, we are only deploying the different components. We are gonna use the demo later, okay? So the very next thing, for those who don't remember the beginning of the presentation, one of the last things we need is Elasticsearch. So for deploying Elasticsearch, the very first thing I need are the CRDs for Elasticsearch. Okay, so I can create an Elasticsearch instance, I can deal with all of that. So let's go ahead. And you are seeing Unchained. I wanted to do it for the presentation. You are seeing Unchained in this case because I already have the CRDs for Elasticsearch installed in this cluster, okay? But you will have seen Created in this case instead of Unchained. And the second step, as with Strimzi, as with Apicurio Registry, is to install the Elasticsearch operator. And in this case, you can see that all the resources required for my Elasticsearch, the Elasticsearch operator, are being created. Now, as I was saying, the very same thing, okay? I need to create my Elasticsearch cluster, so I'm gonna go ahead and create an Elasticsearch instance. You can see here, a new Elasticsearch has been created, and also a route for it to be available has been created. Okay, now, if I go to routes, if I go to Elasticsearch, if it's already available, if not, I will go to the pod itself to see it's still not available, so. You can see here that it's being initialized. Now, if I refresh this thing, okay, now it's available. The classical message, hello world, in this case for Elasticsearch is, you know, for search. It's quite obvious, but this way you know that the Elasticsearch instance is working, okay? So now, what else are we missing for this presentation? I said at the beginning that the very base for the presentation was gonna be the PostgreSQL database. Without it, there is no presentation without the PostgreSQL database, okay? So the next step is gonna be to install this PostgreSQL database. For convenience reasons, as I said at the beginning, this PostgreSQL database already has a few tables created, 5 tables in this case, and some data, a few rows for each table, okay? So now I have the PostgreSQL database. Fine, it's there. I don't need to check it now. And the very next thing is gonna be, when I was talking about the Strimzi, I talked about the Kafka cluster, I talked about Zookeeper, and I talked about Kafka Connect. Kafka Connect is a runtime that allows you to deal with external data, in the sense that allows you to deal with, in our case, with PostgreSQL data and to send data to Elasticsearch. But to be able to deploy my connectors, first of all, I need a Kafka Connect cluster, okay? So let's go ahead and let's create the Kafka Connect cluster. This is gonna create basically 2 pods. The first one is gonna configure the cluster and the second one is gonna be the actual Kafka Connect cluster, okay? So let me filter this thing here. As you can see here, the first one, the build one is running. Once this pod is done, the Kafka cluster, the Kafka Connect cluster will be configured, and another one will appear here that will be the actual Kafka Connect cluster. As you can see here, this one has been completed, and as I promised, another one has appeared that is the actual Kafka Connect cluster. Now, we need to wait for this one to be ready. But same as I said with, in the meantime, same as I said with Kafka, with the Kafka cluster itself, if you go here to Kafka Connect, you can see that the Kafka Connect cluster also appears in the Strimzi user interface. So I have created it manually again, but it's still managed by the Strimzi operator. Okay. Now the status is not ready yet. Let me check the Connect pod. Usually it's just that I'm not patient enough to wait for it to be ready. But sometimes it's worth checking the logs, as you can probably imagine. Okay, now for now everything is going smoothly. I actually think it might be ready. It's ready. So it was that I'm just not patient enough to wait for it to be ready. Okay. Now getting into the interesting part of the presentation. Okay. I'm gonna deploy the very first thing, the PostgreSQL source connector. Source in what sense? In the sense that this is the connector. Sorry, let me deploy it. Not copying it. This way. Okay. So source in what sense? Source in the sense that this is the application that is going to take all the information from the PostgreSQL database, is going to serialize those changes, publish them into Kafka. So all the changes from the PostgreSQL database will be available in the Kafka cluster. Okay. Now, if I did everything correctly, if I go to installed operators, if I go to Strimzi again, and the Kafka connectors are at the end. Okay, you can see that now I have a Postgres connector with the condition ready. And now getting into interesting things. What happened here? Please.
Collecting to the changes in PostgreSQL, is it only insert update or also table changes?
Take the changes. We will see it in the presentation. Taking the changes. Okay, so as you can see in here, now for each table in the database, as I promised, there were five tables, okay? For each table in the database, a new topic in my Kafka cluster has been created. So for instance, I already had some data in the database. If I go here, if I go to the messages, here we have two interesting things. The first one is that in here, you can see that the Kafka UI is not able to deserialize the key for this Kafka message. What is going on? I'm telling it that the information is a string. But as I said, that is not true. All of this is Avro binary data. So, but it's not only that this Avro binary data, but it's that schema is not present in the message itself, it's present in the schema registry. So if I change the key SERD, you can see already that the value SERD is set to schema registry. If I do this, you can see that the key can be deserialized on the fly in the Kafka UI. And if I go to my Apicurio registry UI and I refresh it, you can see that for the values, for the keys and the values for those messages, a new schema in the schema registry has been created. In the sense that I have this is the customer that I was showing, and if I go to the content, you will see that this is Avro, this is an Avro schema that has been inferred from the information in the database, and this is the schema that is now present in my schema registry. So this is the schema that is going to be used to serialize and deserialize all the Kafka messages that are going to be on this topic. This allows what I was saying at the beginning. This allows to enable schema evolution in the sense that if I add a new column to the database that is in some fashion incompatible with evolutions, that message might not end up being in the Kafka cluster because the producer won't be able to serialize that data. Okay, that is an interesting part, and now let's continue with other interesting things. The next interesting thing is we have two separate parts, okay? The first one is information from the Postgres database going to Kafka, and the second one is information from Kafka going into Elasticsearch. For doing that, I need to create the Elasticsearch sync connectors. Connectors because I have five topics, one for each table, so I will have five sync connectors, okay? So if I do it, you can see that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And in the Strimzi UI, you can see that my sync connectors are already present in there, okay? Now the very same thing, here it says what I'm already saying, that you can see it in Strimzi. And now the other interesting part is that this is an extension, it's mentioned in the guide, so don't worry if you don't get something of what's going on. This extension that I'm gonna use, it's mentioned in the GitHub repository and in the guide, okay? So if I go to this extension, here I already have my Elasticsearch cluster connected. If I go here to indexes, what happened here? I already have five Elasticsearch indexes created, one per each topic, one per each table in my PostgreSQL database. So if I go to customers, I'm using and showing customers because they are just convenient for this case. You can see that I have four customers. That is the information that I have available in the database. If I go to the Kafka UI, you can see the very same thing. You can see that there are four Kafka messages, therefore four customers. Okay, it's the very same thing. So I have the information in Postgres, that information is flowing to Kafka and finally getting into Elasticsearch. So all the data pipeline is finally connected. Okay, but now let's do something more interesting. This is fine. I took the data from the database. The data is in Kafka, and the data is in Elasticsearch. But let's use this, right? And let's see how fast this is to actually send information from one place to another. Okay. So what I'm gonna do first is to connect to my PostgreSQL database. Okay. And now let's run. And as we've seen in the Kafka topic in the Elasticsearch, if I do this, I have four customers, okay, fine, great. What happens if I do this? Basically, inserting a new one, okay? What is gonna happen in here? It's already my Kafka cluster. It's already present in there. And what is gonna happen in here? It's already in Elasticsearch as well. A new row has been inserted into the database, and in a matter of milliseconds, I'm actually slower typing to move from one place to another than the data flowing from one side to another, okay? So in a matter of milliseconds, the data has moved from the database to Elasticsearch. But let's make it a bit more interesting in the sense that let's update this customer email to something actually different. And you can see that the email has already changed in Elasticsearch. I'm not even going to the Kafka UI, I'm not even going to Postgres, it's already changed in Elasticsearch. To see and to prove how fast this kind of setup and how fast this kind of deployment is. And finally, kind of the same, but very similar in the sense that I want to show something a bit different in the Kafka UI. Okay, I'm going to delete this this customer in particular. Fine. If I update Elasticsearch, disappeared, no more. And if I go to the Kafka UI, something interesting is going to happen. Instead of just one, now I have two Kafka messages for this customer in particular. What's happening in here? So the first one is pretty obvious. First, I had some information for this related to this message, and this is the this was the information I had. The first name John Doe, and this is the email. And then the data after, obviously, because I have deleted this customer in particular, is null. There is no more, this customer is no more in here. The second message, and that is the interesting part, is a Tombstone message, is a Tombstone Kafka message, in the sense that when Kafka runs the log compaction, it's gonna detect that all the messages associated with this identifier can be removed, because they are no longer relevant for dealing with the with the, this data. There is no more John Doe in the database, so it doesn't make any sense to have John Doe in the Elasticsearch index. So why having the messages in Kafka? Whenever compaction runs, just get rid of those messages. We are using storage for no reason, okay? And this is basically all I wanted to show in the live demo. The conclusion, as you can see in here, is that this is what I was saying, is that I'm actually slower typing and moving from one user interface to another than the data actually flowing from one component to another. And the human in this case is slower than the actual components. That is the very interesting part. And as I was saying, you never miss a bit. You have here messages in Kafka for updating everything, and that's it, right? I mean, this is the live demo. As I said, in the GitHub repository, you have exactly the same set of commands I have executed. The only thing you need is either an OpenShift cluster or a Kubernetes cluster, and you can do exactly the same thing I just done in the presentation. Okay, and now let me go back to the presentation, just because I want to show the classical one last thing, in the sense that in this presentation I have talked about a few projects. The first one was Strimzi. Strimzi is already a CNCF sandbox project. I haven't mentioned one of the cool integrations of these two projects, that is Keycloak. Keycloak is already a CNCF incubating project, and I'm mentioning it here because it has a nice integration with both Apicurio Registry and the Strimzi. And for Apicurio Registry, we are a younger project than Strimzi and Keycloak. We are already present in the CNCF landscape. And last week, if I remember correctly, I submitted the sandbox proposal for CNCF. And that's all. Thank you very much for attending the presentation. And we have a few minutes left if there is any question, I believe.
I didn't understand exactly where was Debezium involved in the demo here.
It's in the Kafka Connect cluster. It adds capabilities to Kafka Connect.
Okay.
Apicurio is usable with other streaming storage than Kafka, such as Apache Parser?
Not right now. We are actually working on a new version of Apicurio Registry right now that will be released in the next year, and we are aiming at having support for other streaming platforms. Like in this case, I'm actually working on the issue for having support for Apache Pulsar. So we are not there yet, but we are trying to get there.
Thank you.
If you don't have any questions right now, you can you have my contact, and you please feel free to drop an email or anything. Right? This is everything is open source, so you can even go to the GitHub repository and open an issue if you want.